Hello, I'm Kevin Francis, and welcome to It's All About Our Relationship. Glad to have you back.
And I'm Gerry Thomas. It's your pleasure to be able to present this to you. We're going to start today with a word of prayer. Our dear God and Heavenly Father, Lord, we just pray that your Spirit would be with us. We know it's with us, Lord, but we just pray that we would be open to its guidance and that you would show us the way, Lord, that we can be your ambassadors and be your voice to the lost. Lord, we just thank you so much for loving us, for the grace that you've given us, and for the fact that we can be part of your family, Lord. Lord, we just, again, we thank you for each person that is taking this class and that is interested in being more effective at sharing the gospel. Lord, be with each of us. Help us to be bold and to be brave enough to and to love others enough, Lord, to share your word as we've been directed. These things we ask in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Well, like in sessions before, today we're going to go over session four. And I'll be presenting this to Gerry, just like you would if you go out and witness to somebody and talk to him. So we'll get started here.
You know, before we do that, Kevin, I just want to give folks a reminder to read along on this effective disciple making for the 21st century that we handed out. You can be anywhere you want to in it. Like I said, this isn't a formal assignment, but last week we talked about chapter 2, and that's to care about people. Mm-hmm. And this week is chapter 3. I thought it was so good. And it's titled Offer. And it starts out with a scripture from Matthew 22 that says, "Now go out to the street corners and invite everyone you see." And of course, you know, on the second page of the chapter, it jumps back in as a reminder that 2 Corinthians 5, we're told that we're ambassadors. Mm-hmm. And if you get a chance, read that, because it goes a long way towards helping you be more practical about and effective about telling others about the gospel.
So. Good idea. Well, Gerry, I'm glad you wanted to meet with me again. We'll do another session here. And before, we talked about why we need God, the covenant and the promise that God gave to us, and how do we start our confession and baptism. Well, today we're going to talk about some unique results of a restored relationship with Jesus.
Okay.
So if you have your papers there, we're going to go down the left side to start off with. I don't know the author of this person, Gerry, that wrote this, but it says one person's definition of a Christian. A Christian is a person who is becoming what, in God's eyes, he already is. And we have there, too, a similar statement found in the Bible, because by one sacrifice we have made perfect forever those who are being made holy. That's Hebrews 10:14. There are two dimensions of a relationship operating at the same time. Because of his love for us, God makes us perfect in his sight forever by our position. Once we are in Jesus, God patiently works to transform us to our condition. So if we go down the left side, in our position, a place, we are in him who is true, even in his son Jesus Christ. He is the true God and eternal life. That's 1 John 5:20. It's a gift, a free gift. And if you know what a gift is, it's we didn't have to do anything, or it's just given to us. And for it's by the grace you have been saved through faith, and this is not for yourself, it is a gift from God. Not by works, so that no one can boast. And that is Ephesians 2 through 8. It's unchanging, and we can count on it. That's what you can always count on, this promise. It's unchanging. I write these things to you to believe in the name of the Son of God, so that you may know that you have eternal life. That's 1 John 5:13. No fearing. We don't need to fear that it's not, you know, going to be there. And all equal, there is neither Jews nor Greeks, slaves nor free, male nor female, for you all are in Christ Jesus. We're the two positions we have, though, we're either in it or we're not. And so the position is, do we accept Christ's gift or do we not accept Christ's gift? So we need to find out that. And if we accept, we're a new person. Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. The old one is gone, the new one has come. And this is our promise through God. Our spiritual position in Jesus is a result of being loved. 1 John 4:19 says, we love because he first loved us. He loved us, came for us, died, and was raised from the dead, and now adopts us as sons and daughters. We are deeply loved, knowing this will change our hearts and mind and life. It's all about relationship. So it's changing our heart. But this, we are part of God's family. And to be part of God's family is very good. It's always good to be a part of a family and to be loved and accepted by that family. Now, down the right side of this page, it's our condition, our spiritual shape. It's a journey. Being confident of this, that he who began a good works in you will carry it on to completion till the day Christ Jesus. And that's in Philippians 1:6. God is working to transform us. So he wants to see a change. He's working to change us, and that's how we do it. A work in progress. Seems like we all can be a work in progress. Train yourself to be godly, for physical training is of some value, but godliness has value for all things, holding promise for both the present life and the life to come. And that means we need to put something into it. So we need to cooperate in this transformation. So we need to be willing and open and put something into it. And Paul said, and we are being transformed into the likeness with ever-increasing glory. And so unequal, not all equal in our condition. So we can be in different conditions, and it may all be equal in those conditions. Though by the time you ought to be teachers, you need some to teach all over again. You need milk, not solid food. Anyone who lives on milk, being still as an infant. But solid food is for mature who have consisted of having trained themselves in distinguishing good from evil. So we start out on milk because we are new in Christ and we're small. But we need to work to that maturity level. And this is a lifelong thing to come to that maturity level. And we need to change. We need to have a new attitude. You were taught with regarding to your former ways of life to put off the old self, which is being corrupted by deceitful desires, to be made new in the attitude of your mind, and to put on new selves created to be like God. That's Ephesians 4:22 to 24. In our spiritual condition, we're loved by God. Our spiritual condition reflects our response to our being loved. God's Holy Spirit is working in our lives to help us produce the fruit of the Spirit. We show our love and gratitude to God by trusting and obeying Him. And it's all about our relationship with God. So we need to work on our relationship with God. Now on this next page, we have this bar graph here, the very top. And this is kind of the concept that some people think about. And they think this is correct, but it's not actually correct. If you look to the far left of the very top there, we think like a pastor or preacher, they're at the level already to go to heaven. So, you know, just by them being a pastor or preacher. And you may think there might be some neighbors that, you know, you see them go to church and do things, and you think they're a little bit above that or just a little bit below the pastor level. So they're closer to the line of going to heaven. Well, then you have a friend, and you really know that they're not quite what they should be doing. But you think, okay, I'm a little bit better than them. And they're down a little bit lower from life. And yourself, you think, I'm a good person. I'm doing the right things. So, you know, I'm a little closer to going to heaven. Well, many say things like this. Me, I want to go to heaven, but when I see where I am at and where I have to get, it seems hopeless. There's no chance. So you can be pretty low and think, there's no way that I can make it to heaven. Not by where I'm at, the condition I'm in. The truth is, when we accept Christ, we are immediately made 100% perfect in God's eyes. Our position, we're going to heaven. That gift I was telling you about. We are made perfect forever because of God's grace and our position in Christ. He then works to help us become more like Christ as He works on our condition. Because by one sacrifice, He has made perfect forever those who are being made holy. Okay, down underneath that, we talk about God saved you by the grace when you believed. And you can't take credit for this. It's a gift from God. Salvation is not a reward for the good things we have done. So none of us can boast about it. So that's in Ephesians. So it's not by our works. Our position gives us peace, joy, hope, confidence till the end of our lives during the condition and transformation. And I'm certain that God will begin a good works within you, will continue to work with you until it is finally finished on the day when Jesus Christ comes. Paul said that in Philippians 1:6. When will God be finished with our transformation? We are saved because of our position, not our condition. That is the grace of God. So, you know, not our condition, but our position. If we're in Christ, we're saved. This conclusion almost always raises the question, does this mean it's not important to be good? No, our condition is not important. We need our condition to be. The answer found in the New Covenant is that it is important. We should not abuse or take God's gift for granted. Live as free men, but do not use your freedom as a cover-up for evil. Live as a servant of God. That is in 1 Peter 2:16. The Apostle Paul wrote, I don't mean to say I am perfect. I haven't learned all I should yet. But I keep working towards that day when I will finally be at all that Christ saved me for and wants me to be. That's in Philippians 3:12. Jesus loves me just as I am, but He has no plans of leaving that way. So there's going to be a change here. And we need to work on that change. My old motivation was to make me look good in order to be saved. If I do what I do, so I will look good. Selfishness and fear are my motivations. I become self-centered, covered up, denying and comparing. I will never know if I have done enough. That is how God's religion attempts to control us through fear. So we need to motivate by God's love and grace. We need to be motivated. I seek to be like Jesus, to honor God and show Him my love, gratitude, and appreciation for my salvation and all He has done for me. I know we can't do enough, but that He has already done what needs to be done for me to have eternal relationship with Him. So that gift that He gives us, Strengthen my relationship with Jesus is my new motivation. I am powerless without my relationship with Jesus. That's John 15:5. Now we come to a page that has a graph there. And on the left side, life's journey out of Christ. Before we had Christ in this darkened area here, life outside of Christ, we were facing death. We were cursed. We were spiritually dead, lost in darkness, hopelessness to save ourselves. But in Christ, it's when we believe in Christ, sacrifice, Christ's sacrifice, repent, confession, and are baptized, we cross over from death into life. This is our life's journey in Christ. This white section in between there represents our entire life in Christ. It shows our position and condition. For He, which is God, chose us to in Him, which is Jesus, before the creation of the world, to be holy and blameless in His sight. Ephesians 1:4. Because of our position in Christ, we are now 100% perfect in God's eyes, our position. For the rest of our lives, when we die, God has already made us for heaven. And how's that? That's pretty good, isn't it? So if you'll look at this bottle of water that's at the top of the mountain, we ask ourselves, it's because of our position. Can you see through the water inside without first looking through the bottle? No. It'd be hard to do, even though you have to look through the bottle. In much the same way when God looks at us after we accept Christ, He sees through Jesus. We are in Christ and continually cleansed by His blood, made blameless or perfect. Well, if you can see right here, like I said, this is our life's journey going up to the bottle. And you can see that we start out our life with Christ and go uphill is our conditions. And sure, we'll have some setbacks, but we keep climbing. We need to keep climbing. And through our lives, we may see more setbacks. And so our goal is to reach the bottle and see Christ through. Paul said, and we all are being transformed into His image, 2 Corinthians 3:18. Through our transformation, we are becoming what in God's sight we already are. In our journey, we will still face unexpected, unpleasant, and even painful situations. There are hills to climb, valleys to cross, and storms to face. Our condition reflects the spiritual shape we are in, strong or weak. Everyone's journey is different, but the destination's the same. A transformation is taking place. And Paul says, aim for perfection, acting and reacting like Jesus. Sin misses the mark. So if we shoot for the bullseye, heaven, we can miss the mark. So sin misses the mark. In Christ, God is not counting men's sins against Him. So God doesn't count our sins against us. At Christ's second coming, we will be resurrected, Revelations 21. And we will be finished, mature, Colossians 3, 1 through 4. If you go to the next page, what is Christian to do when he sins? Well, sometimes it is some things to be avoided. We will sin after becoming a Christian. We are learning, growing, struggling, and sometimes we fail. It's part of the transformation journey. So there's going to be some sins. We all stumble in many ways, James 3:3. Many have mistaken ideas of God's forgiveness. They have a concept called a line religion. You can see it there. The line above the line is we're saved. The line below, we're lost. And through our journey, we can be above the line at first. We're saved. Then we can think that we sinned. We had sin and we're below the line. And then we can come back again and rebound and be above the line because we talk to God and ask for forgiveness. Everything starts fine. We accept Christ and we are moving. Then we sin and we feel like we have fallen below the line. We pray, Lord, forgive me. We hope we are above the line again, at least until the next sin. With time, doubt arises. Am I above the line or below? We lose our sense of peace and security, and fear sets in. This is not how God works. And what should we do when we sin? It's clear. If we confess our sins, He is faithful and just, and He will forgive us of our sins and purify us from all unrighteousness. To confess is not saying, I'm sorry, rather it's saying, I did it. Confess means that we agree with God that what we did was a sin and we accept responsibility for it. Why do we need to confess? It keeps the line of communication open in order to continue growing in relationship with Jesus. An example, sin. Adam and Eve sinned. They hid from God. When they tried to hide our sins from Him, we shut Him out. We close our hearts to Him. We are weakened and more vulnerable to destruction and attitudes and behavior. God wants us to be close to Him and His family. We to trust and love Him. He is waiting for us to confess. I'll give you another example of that. If you've ever been to the circus, you see the high wire artist doing amazing routines. The safety net gives him confidence to be bold. He does what he doesn't want to fall, but there's a protection in case he does. God calls us to step out and follow Him in a radical new life. We don't want to fall or fail God. There's protection in case we do, though. God's grace is our safety net. What if we don't confess? Those whom I love, I rebuke and discipline, so be earnest and repent. This verse is a loving promise from God. Our fathers disciplined us for a little while as they thought best, but God disciplines us for our good, that we may share in His holiness. No discipline seems pleasant at the time, but painful. Later on, however, it produces a harvest of righteousness and peace for those who have been trained by it. That's in Hebrews. And sometimes God's discipline is doing nothing. He gives us time to reflect and understand our sin and know it gets us closer to God. And we pray to Him and talk to Him, and He'll help us through it, but sometimes His discipline is just giving us a little time. Accepting responsibility for our actions, telling God that we agree, that we sinned, declaring our intent to change, giving thanks to God for His forgiveness, seeking to restore my damaged relationship. The New Covenant teaches us to repeatedly ask for forgiveness. We already have it. It was a promise. We need to continually confess our sins, thank God for His forgiveness, and then live according to God's way. If you ask me for a pencil, and I give you the pencil, then if you ask me again, give me the pencil, you already have the pencil. You can keep asking me how many times you need to, but you have the pencil. And that's what we have, God's grace. But if we walk in the light as he is in the light, we have fellowship with one another, and the blood of Jesus, his son, purifies us from every sin. So it's the blood of Jesus Christ that purifies us. Does this make sense to you? Do you have any questions?
No, not now, but you give me a lot to think about.
That's good. Do you know anyone who needs a new relationship with God?
I think we probably all do.
Yes. Yeah, so thank you for meeting with me again. And like I said, we went through four sessions here, and I hope you go back and reflect on that and look at it. And here again, thank you for meeting with me, and I've had a good time talking to you about this. Thank you.
Well, you've had a chance to go through all four of the It's All About Relationship lessons. We said earlier, I think when we started this class, that there wouldn't be any homework, but guess what? We've got an assignment for you. We'd like for you to find someone to practice these four lessons with, much like Kevin and I did with each other. You'll find that the more times you do it, the easier it'll become. Now, it's so easy just to give someone a track or talk to them about the five-finger exercise to be saved. What we've given you here is a tool. I'd give anything if I had this kind of explanation given to me back when I was 21 years old and ready to accept the Lord, because mm-hmm. I didn't understand much at all about what's in here. I understood that I was a sinner and that I needed to, you know, as I was told then, I needed to confess, to repent, you know, and of course belief came first, and then be baptized into Christ. But this is such a good comprehensive, there's no doubt that if someone sits through these lessons, I think they'll understand all about the decision that's being offered to them. And we'd encourage you to find someone to practice this with. And probably in about another 2 weeks, we're going to ask you to find someone outside of your family, maybe someone that needs Christ, and to go through it with. But this isn't the only tool. I know that some people don't feel comfortable reading to someone, and that's what this is. This is just you don't have to memorize anything. You just sit down, read these to a person that's wanting to hear them. Mm-hmm. But what we've done, as we mentioned several times, we put together a little more concise version of these four lessons. We've taken all the important things out of here. Everything in here is really important, and mm-hmm. I think what it does, it helps someone make a decision that'll last because they understand more about what they're doing.
Yes.
So many times a decision for Christ is made from some kind of maybe a person's in a real low spot in their life, or maybe they're in a real emotional frame of mind and they're reaching out for something, and this comes along and they grab onto it without realizing what it was they grabbed onto. Mm-hmm. And I think these lessons are so great. It helps you build a relationship with the person as you're going through it as well. And that's kind of what it's all about. But we do have this comprehensive one that we'll be going through next week. And then something that we can use in addition to those two, or maybe to go along with those two as you're presenting them to someone, we've had a couple pamphlets here that kind of gets down to the heart of the gospel.
Okay.
And we're real excited about all these tools and about what's going to be coming up. Don't forget to read your effective disciple making. It'll help you with your frame of mind and gives you a lot of things to think about when it comes to being a witness for Christ.
Amen.
So do you have anything more to add, Kevin?
Well, I just want to say too, the more you do this, the better you get at it.
Yes.
I'm an example. I started in this, and I've been through three or four now, and it helps.
Yeah.
It helps to have the tool. It helps to have this here with me. And I feel like God is asking us to do this, and this is what we need to do. And so.
Great. I really appreciate you. Yeah. And it's been a real pleasure for me to team up with you on
this. You too. Yes.
Thank you all again.
Thank you.